first question.
Okay.
Hello.
I'm gonna start again. I'm gonna go through.
All right, I think we're live. So, hello guys. We're doing our Patreon live stream.
Sorry,
we got a little delayed. We're here now. Anyway, we got a couple questions here we're gonna answer before we get into that. Just want to tell you guys a little bit about Patreon. If you're new to what we're doing here, what we're doing is the first half hour or so of the live stream, we're answering questions from our Patreon members. And if you want to get in on that, just check out our Patreon link. There's an annotation or a card up there at the top right. You can click on that and find the link to there. So we got our first goal that's coming up. So that's going to be giveaways. Once we get there, then we're going to be doing some monthly giveaways for you guys. So help us get there. We got a few different tier rewards for you guys if you sign up for that. So you can get whenever we do one of these, you'll get notified as well. If you sign up for that tier, you'll get your questions answered first. There's a discount on our merch store, so we do have a merch store. And then we have a secret link to one that has Canadian pricing, so it's a little cheaper for you. Also what's on there is our Facebook group. So if you want to join our Facebook group, you got a growing community there. I think there's, how many people there right now? Like almost 200 people there?
Is that more than that?
More than 200?
Closer to 300, aren't we? Yeah, it doesn't matter. Lots of guys there.
Lots of guys there. If you guys have questions about your builds, or just want to show some pictures of what you're doing, your progress.
Or want to sell stuff.
Buy and sell things. Oh, yeah. Just head over there.
Yeah, neat little hangout there.
Yeah, got a link up there as well, in the corner here. I'll link everything down below later too, so you can check that out. We've also got Drive Tribe. Now, we're going to be looking at some of what's going on here. So Drive Tribe, if you guys follow the Grand Tour and...
Or Top Gear, it's the guys from Top Gear that are now doing Grand Tour, but not all of us have Amazon. So they started Drive Tribe, and that's pretty cool because it's you share videos and build forums and that on your build, and that's cool. A great place to share your build and check out everybody else's for inspiration and whatever too. Is it interactive too?
Yeah. You can leave comments and stuff like that. What was really cool is that people are able to leave or show like albums of if you've got a really cool car that you want to show us. We're gonna go look at some of those like now, and we'll also share these on our social channels. So we're gonna take a look at some of those projects. Also coming up next weekend, we're gonna be at Motorama. On March 11th, that's in Toronto. So it's Toronto.
Mississauga.
So
the right side of Toronto, because it's the west side of Toronto, so it's closer for us.
Yeah. Nice. So if there's anyone local that's watching, you can let us know if you want to meet up. But we're gonna be there. So looking at some cool cars. Our friend Randy is there. Randy's entered this. He's entered into Motorama how many times? Like. Five times or something.
I thought it was six, and he's won four of the six times for best car. Yeah. So
we're gonna see what he's got in there too. He's got a few cars in.
Okay.
They're not all in contest, but we're gonna check out some of those. So.
Yeah.
That'll be fun.
So hopefully, our goal is to kind of have something cool, not for, like, this year, but something cool to bring to Motorama next year, and actually have a booth there. So, that's the ultimate goal. Start with Motorama, which is like Canada's, one of Canada's bigger shows for shops and kind of do-it-yourself, not so much automotive car show stuff where it's all new. This is all stuff that people are building. And then hopefully work our way down to see them at some point. That'd be cool.
Yeah. So we'll get into it. We got a few questions popping up here. So, first question here let me see here. 1990 Ram W250 with the VE pump. Do you plan on doing any performance upgrade videos? Fuel pin, RPM, governor spring, turned out the fuel, 16 centimeter turbine, 60-pound valve springs, ARP head studs, essentials. Essentially, that's the plan for my truck, under the hood anyway.
So, under the Tahoe build, there was a whole section where I built the VE pump for the 4-cylinder. It's the exact same for the 6-cylinder. So I put the 3200 governor springs in there, fuel pin, messed with the aneroid valve and the smoke screw. I show you how to be careful how not to blow up your truck, because if you turn the fuel screw too much, you can have a runaway with that VE. And then unless you start getting into crazy boost, that won't be enough to do anything where I think you need head gaskets. You'll notice a difference, but it's not going to like crank the engine to the holy crap way. So if you're going to do that, you're going to need bigger injectors and a different turbo setup. And once you start running more than, say, 25, 30 pounds of boost, then and that's still safe with bolts if you're... But that's about the time you want to consider studs. So I wouldn't be too worried about studs with just mods to the pump. But that whole video is already out there, so check it up. It's under the Tahoe build.
Yeah. Another question, will you be making a full 12-valve rebuild video next time you get one that needs it?
Yes. Basically, whatever comes in the shop, we're going to make a video on it. The 12-valve... Right now, I think the next one is going to be a 3.3 liter Cummins, which is not a 12 valve, but more or less the same idea. That one, I think, is going into an Escalade, if that plan works through. The customer, nothing's set in stone yet, but the customer's having a hard time finding an Escalade that's not all rotten. So if you guys have one, just post it on the Boss Garage Facebook, and I should have asked for that there already. But we're looking for that and an NV3500 or an NV4500 to put in that. So that'll be a cool build. So I'll definitely do the 3.3 rebuild, hopefully. And then, the Commander was always the plan to tear down the red 12 valve that came out of the Silverado, tear it down and try to figure out why it was never running 100%. And rebuild that to put fresh into the Commander. So, and then I would definitely do the head studs on that, because of hoping to twin turbo that one too. So, but that's all when money comes in. GTO's still first. So.
Yeah.
So it's definitely in the makes. That's it's gonna happen at some point.
Yeah. Have you had any issues with your swaps when it comes to registration or e-tests? Heard Ontario is in the process of not allowing engine swap vehicles to pass emissions anymore.
Yeah, so this one, there are ways to get around it, and the e-test is such a silly thing if you ask me. I wish they would just get right away from the e-test and just make every vehicle get a safety every year, which actually serves some sort of purpose. If your vehicle can't pass safety, then most likely it'll fail emissions, but that whole joke of a thing kind of pisses me off. And last time, so far I haven't had any issues, but yeah, the Ontario emissions are so funny in the fact that anything north of Huntsville doesn't even need e-tests. So that's one thing. And so there's ways to get around it. So far I haven't run into an issue, but that's all I'm gonna say, I guess. Supposedly, you can get EFI Live to turn off the monitors so you can pass with a not ready, but I can't. So we're getting a sponsor for HP Tuners, but I'm sure HP Tuners wouldn't be too happy if I showed you how to bypass an e-test with it, so that's not going to happen. So at some point, maybe I'll just say whether it's possible or not with the HP tuner, but it definitely can't show you how to do it. But there is ways around it, and I think if the Conservatives next election I think on their platform they'll probably say we'll get rid of the e-test just to get some of our votes back.
If you could pick any truck SUV to have a 12-valve in it, what would you want? Or would you still have your Silverado? Sure looks a lot more comfortable than a 90s Ram. I bet you don't hit the roof with your head anymore crossing the railroad tracks.
And that's 100% why I put it in the Silverado. And if I could, and I get to live in this awesome world where if I could pick any vehicle to put the 12-valve in, I would put it in my regular cab long box Silverado. I love that truck. I always have, even with the family. I don't think I'd enjoy driving a crew cab as much. I just love the look of the truck, and I love that truck. So even though I'm taking my sweet time building it, it's one of those things I love the fact of building it and enjoying it. I don't even necessarily even have to drive it that much. Right now the Tahoe's still holding up and our Saturn's holding up, so the Silverado's more or less for our Saturn that my wife drives has 340,000 K on it. At some point it's gonna let go, so then she'll drive the Tahoe for a bit, and then if she doesn't like it enough, we'll get another small car, keep the Tahoe for the family, but then I'll put the Silverado on the road type of thing. But that's more or less why I built it. But yeah, I love the Silverado. And then the next thing would be the Cummins Commander. Next one I want. It's just, that's in my head. That's what's going to get a 12-valve next.
Yeah. So next question is would you put the 12-valve in the GTO and make 1,000 horsepower?
I can't, because it's a true 242 GTO. If it was just a regular plain Jane Pontiac, yeah, I'd consider it for sure. Somebody gave me the idea of Duramax too, and so there is Duramax in the shop with an Allison 5-speed Allison in it, and I like to put that in something cool, and I consider putting that in a muscle car. It's actually a lot lighter still than the 12-valve is, so it's a little easier on the suspension. But I typically consider the 12-valve to be a truck engine, not too much else.
So. And then is the crew cab square body done? Raymond emailed about buying parts.
Yeah, the crew cab long box is 100% done on my end. He told me it was lined up to get painted, and I think it might be getting painted this winter yet. He's not driving it in the winter, it's done, but I think that patch that was off of the door on the back on the passenger, they're painting that, and then they're sanding it down and then clear coating it as is, and then an interior is going into it later. I won't be doing the interior either. We have a really good interior lady, same lady that did the Fleet Master will be doing the interior in it, but as for my mechanical end of it, it's done. The tailgate's all fixed. Like, there's nothing else to do other than an oil change. We'll do an update on it, but really hasn't driven it since the fall. So we'll go over it, tighten all the bolts again, make sure that all the four-wheel drive stuff and that is tight. I told him to put 10,000 K on it or something, and then bring it back. So
he wants parts from I think the blue.
That blue one is gone, but I have the same owner has that video we made. We didn't make a video on that, right? We've got a 1990 blue four-wheel drive regular cab long, but yeah, everything I hate about my Dodge.
Yeah.
So that truck is still in one piece. So if you guys want it, that's fine. And I think I know what you're talking about. I didn't measure the rims. He doesn't want to sell the four-wheel drive light, and there's one other thing that he would let go of. Oh, the emblem in the front, $20. So I think that's you.
Oh yeah?
Yeah.
The emblem, like the.
Yeah, the Dodge thing he says he wants $20 for. We were thinking about selling a whole bunch of stuff, and then it gets complicated because it's his truck, but I need to cut because I'm doing all the work to it. Stripping an emblem off isn't bad, but then you gotta mail it, figure out the cost of mailing it. And then all of a sudden there's like 45 minutes gone. And I can charge you $20 for the stupid emblem and shipping, or I could just work on somebody's vehicle for my shop rate and actually make a decent wage at it. So we're still trying to figure that out, how that's going to work effectively, and that might be another job for Mechanic Aaron, is to get more on the computer in the shop and start selling parts and posting parts
and kind of managing that, I can't do it. And then I realized that I just can't. It's just too much. So, and the guy with the Fleet Master gun, I apologize if you're on here watching. He wanted a little crank handle for the corner glass. I have it. I'm sorry. There's just so much going on.
Dave DeWolf asks, how much did it cost to build your brother's shop without concrete?
Without concrete.
It's Canadian dollars, just so.
Yeah, so it was pretty well 20,000 Canadian right on. It was, I charged him $6,000 labor just for the other guys too. His Luke and Wayne were there, and then the materials came to 14,000. So that is 28 gauge steel, 2x6 in the flat. The vapor barrier was on there, the Tyvek, and plain Jane. The doors and windows all finished, closed in. It was pretty well to like a couple $100, $20,000. So.
Cool. That's it for Patreon questions so far.
Sometimes it's dirty.
Already on.
Yeah.
Let me just see.
So just for you guys on Patreon, I just want to thank you guys again for supporting us. We got a mic that we're starting to work out more for better sound. You can see it on that Germax video and a couple other ones. We used it, and I'm trying to figure out how far and how close to put it to make it sound good. But I've driven over another camera now, so I think I've got four. Am I on my fifth camera now? I think I'm on my fifth camera, yeah. Unfortunately. Aaron got a better camera, a 70DD.
70D, Canon 70D.
70D, so yeah. So that's a really good camera. It does everything except slow-mo. And we just got these Akaso 4K. They're like GoPros, except different. So our old GoPro is pretty well toast. So we're going to try those guys out and go from there. And the plans are hopefully, you guys saw some drone shots. That was one of the guys that we were working with a little bit. Pete Hessels, right? Yeah, Pete Hessels. So I'll give him a shout out. But we're hoping to get a drone in the next, 6 months?
Yeah, probably by spring.
Yeah.
Aiming for that.
Yeah, we got some cool ideas coming up. So a drone will be in the picture, and that's because of your guys' support. It's a little bit right now, but it helps. It helps quite a bit.
Yeah, cool. So we're gonna switch gears a little bit. We're gonna head over to Drive Tribe. Before we do that, we're gonna go live. So
to Drive, we're doing Drive Tribe.
Yeah, I just figured
Oh, so they can see that?
Yeah, we'll just kind of look at some of the... Yeah, I got some stuff happening. So, give me a second here. Do you want to talk about the Corvette? Talk about the Corvette a little bit.
Oh, okay, yeah. There's a whole section missing. If you guys are wondering why it takes me so long to do my stupid projects. One, the LS is new to me. It's a whole new world, and it takes a long time for us to get parts. It's not like we're down south and we can have parts next day. Sometimes it takes a couple of weeks, and so far I haven't ordered any of the wrong stuff. Everything's fitting together. But in the meantime, the deal was that thing was going to be done for spring, and the engine's just about ready to go on the dyno. But in between, I got a lot of projects, and somebody donated to Rick a 1976 Corvette, and it needed quite a bit of work. I know God's, Rick is one of God's favorites, but everybody keeps giving him holy cars, and that's annoying to me because it takes a lot of work. So we put new floors in it, and got it running, tune up, new brake lines, fuel lines, the steering cylinder has to be rebuilt yet. But the cool thing was we bought, just found out today that, the floor pans had to be replaced, and there's no way to do it without new. They're pretty wonky, and the seat like goes into it. The seat belt is part of the inside of the floor. So we bought new floor pans for it from Northern Corvette, and they're pretty big. They're one of the bigger Corvette places in North America, I would say. Amazing shop, nice guys. But apparently Rick and I came along pretty strong when we met the, there's a couple partners, and we're like, hi, yeah, we need floor pans, and this is Rick, and we got a YouTube channel, and whatever, and I had no problem paying full price for the pans, and then, Rick was at one of his guys, they have a meeting once a week with just a bunch of older guys, like anywhere from 30s and up, they meet called The Barn. And one of the guys bought a new exhaust shop, so they went over to open up the exhaust shop and kind of pray over the thing. And one of the guys was talking to Rick, and Rick started talking about his Corvette, and he's like, yeah, you know, we're building this vet and blah blah, and we got these floor pans, and they worked really good, saved a lot of time. And he goes, oh, you must have been talking to my partner then. So unknowingly, he's talking to the other one, even though he's been at the same meeting for months already. So Northern Corvette really hooked us up. Today they gave us a bumper, new seat covers for it, all the little pieces that were missing, spring kits for the emergency brakes. So Rick was really excited about that. So we can put the last of the car together, and then Dixon Auto Body in Welland is going to paint it for us. So he's going to paint it, and then that's kind of be kind of the showpiece for Ozzy's garage. Ozzy lives in Port Colborne, and the car show is actually one street over from where his shop is going to be. So whether the vet's running or not, and the point isn't to finish the whole car, but the point is to get it safety and on the road, and they'll do all the little things like they'll put the radio in and get the windows and everything working properly, and that's perfect for the kind of walk-ins that are going to happen in the shop. But at the same time, there's a car show once a week, one street over, so they can bring the car there every week, not finished, and just say, like, this is what we're doing, this is what we're doing, what our goals are, to work with the men and stuff, have people walking in. And we really got to get his shop going, because there's, like, a lot of walk-ins happening in my shop now, and it's taking a lot of time away from me. So the Corvette is kind of slowing down the rest of the shop, but it's just one of those projects. In between there was a motorhome with a Cummins. That video's coming out. There was that skidder. And then I got just some small jobs, like brake jobs on a Jeep and stuff like that. There's no point in making a video on that. It's just boring, monotonous stuff. This is how you change your rotors. And so that's why the other projects take longer. But that kind of, while I'm figuring out everything on the LS, those are nice little small jobs to get some cash flowing still.
Yeah. Cool. Well, if you guys are just joining us, I know we have about 7 people watching now. We've just been answering questions live. How long have we been doing this now? Well, the last 20 minutes or so with our Patreon exclusive members. And now we're just opening it up for you guys. If you got any questions, just comment in the live chat, and we'll try to get to them. And let's see. We're going to take a look at our drive in a minute.
Got a question. I love it. Already. Dipmaster, hey, I asked you on your live stream, what was your opinion on putting a Cummins in an 85 Regal? It's done now, and it's fucking awesome. That's awesome. I love it. You know, it's funny, because I was thinking about you today. Just for I was walking out to the car to come here, and I'm like, I really enjoyed the last chat, and especially your question. And it's like, should I do it? I'm like, yes, definitely you should do it, because if you guys weren't here before, it's like, you will get more attention with an 85 Regal and a 12 valve than if somebody your age went out and bought a brand new Camaro or a brand new truck, because you've got respect. Like, you've done that, and it is unique, it is yours, and it's awesome. So I'm glad that you finished it, and that I hope you get a lot of head turning with that, and you meet a lot of cool people with that. So
speaking of that, actually, we're heading over to our drive tribe page. We're gonna show you guys.
Yeah.
And Dipmaster, if you want, put a little gallery together and put it on our drive tribe, and we'll show everybody what you've done.
yeah, I want to see that one. I think.
Yeah, throw a picture up.
I think for us telling you to do it, you got to at least put a picture up on Drive Tribe and on DeVos Garage Facebook. If you're behind the computer anyway, take some pictures and do it.
Yeah, we just click on the little annotation up at the top right corner, and you can find our Drive Tribe page there, a second one down.
We got all this technology.
There you go. And let's switch over here. So we're on our Drive Tribe page. This is what it looks like. and just wanted to kind of see what's getting posted here. I posted a couple things, and I thought this was pretty sweet. We've been talking about what would it look like to do a wrap that looked like Russ.
Yeah. And it's not uncommon. There's lots of guys that I don't really like his that much because the hood is still white. It's like he was supposed to put a different hood on it. I like the leaking rust, kind of like Swamp Thing out of Vegas Rat Rods, or Swamp, whatever the Swamp Thing is. But yeah, that's still pretty cool.
That's pretty cool. This person is not a member of our thing, but...
Yeah, so we can bash it. All right, yeah, don't put the hood a different color, come on. is the Escalade 5-speed on there?
Yeah,
there he is, right on.
Here we go, this is from Andrew Lemur.
Very nice job.
Let's just pull this up here. So he did a, what did he do? 4BT in this?
Yeah, with an NV3500. Awesome job.
Yeah, some photos here.
Nice.
He says, all my OEM gauges are working through DLS computer, TAC, Speedo, water, oil, volt, and fuel gauge.
Yeah, and we'll still figure out how to get your reduced engine power and everything off. Very nice.
Yeah, and I think he posted a video here too, so you can actually hear it. Let me see how this goes. I don't know if you guys can hear this.
I can't hear it, so... There it is. That's awesome. Perfect. Got a little crank sensor on the front. Nice job. Right on.
Sweet.
Love it.
Yeah. That's nice.
Very nice.
A lot of photos there. Yeah.
Triple gauge pod.
There's that one. Let's go back here. Just got a questions here. Yeah, if you guys got questions, just leave a comment. We'll try to get to them.
Why I don't like the Fords. I'll just go over that quick. That video, I'm not happy with the video of why I don't like Fords, because that was actually, we went to my old boss's place who just put a Cummins in an F550 because the 6.4, the second 6.4 blew up in it on less than 300,000 kilometers on it. And none of the shop guys wanted to go on camera. We made a video on the 550, and then my old boss called me up and told me that we didn't have the right to make that video, even though he gave me the keys to it, and that we had to take the video down. And I didn't really get the point across on why I don't like Fords. They just have a lot of little things that bug me. Some of the things I said in the video was that their fuse panels aren't labeled, and not all of them aren't labeled, but the ones that I work on, which was mostly the trucks, the fuse panels aren't labeled. So something that should take 10 seconds to flip over the cover and see which fuse does the wipers, because your wipers aren't working. It's a pain in the ass because you got to go into the owner's manual and open up the manual, find the page, put the, and it just takes 5 minutes instead of 10 seconds, and that bothers me. And a lot of the stuff that I've come across, like the F-150s that weld the yoke in front of the hanger bearing, make you buy a whole new drive shaft. It sucks when the customer comes in and says, oh, I need a drive shaft, and it didn't happen to me. It happened on that F-150 that I put the engine in. He drove it to a shop and dropped the drive shaft and then asked me, where do you get a drive shaft? But it sucks as a business when you feel bad giving them a bill for an entire drive shaft. And there's no money to be made to like mark it up, because like, okay, well, the drive shaft's $1,800 and I still gotta do the labor to put it in, so your bill's gonna be like $2,000. And it's like, ah, it sucks. And my biggest thing was really the power strokes, and they know that they had problems on it, and a lot of the comments on the power strokes was, the one guy said, I got a job at the the Navistar assembly plant. My job was to disassemble all the 6.4s that are brand new, because they all failed quality control. And Ford knew they had a problem, Navistar knew they had a problem, and they knew, like, they gotta know, oh, we're blowing a lot of head gaskets, how about we stud them for factory, and we could fix that, but they don't. And Ford goes with OEM. If you bring it back to a dealership, they just put OEM in it, so even if the head gasket's gonna go again, they're not gonna stud it for you, they're gonna put head gaskets in it with the regular factory bolts, and it's gonna blow again. And it's fine now that the power strokes, when I say power strokes, I mean 6 and 6.4 and 6.7. When the 6s came out in 2003, nobody knew how to fix them, so the head gaskets went. They just put more head gaskets in it, and that was it. Now, 10 years later, 15 years later, we know, okay, if you do this, and you do this, and you do this, then you can make a reliable engine. That's true. But a lot of people got screwed over in the meantime by not knowing this information when the engines first came out. And those engineers had a 10-year or 5-year, at least 5 years of engineering jump on the regular public. So they should have known in the late 90s already, when they were designing the engine, that they were gonna have an issue and how they could fix it, but they chose not to. And a lot of people spent a lot of money fixing these stupid power strokes because they didn't have the information on how to do it. My buddy was one of them, running a landscaping business. He had the engine, their head gaskets done twice under warranty, and then they had a whole slew of problems again after his warranty ran out and just about put him under. You know, you're a young guy, we were in our mid-20s, we're just getting married, we've got new mortgages, and we're all going self-employed. And he goes out and buys his power stroke, and it just about put his business under because he paid $30,000 for the truck and he paid $30,000 to keep it running at the Ford dealership. And then he says, you know what, enough is enough. I got $60,000 in his pile of crap, and he wants to sell it back to him. And Ford says Ford wouldn't even buy it back from him. And it's little personal experiences like that kind of get to me. I'm sure people have had those experiences with GM and Dodge. It's just that I haven't. So I don't like the Fords. I don't like the dinging on the stupid key. I don't like that if you have to pull the key all the way out, that instead of just sliding it out slightly, so you're working on it, you need key power, you get pissed off because something's broken and you don't know what it is. You take the keys, you pull it out of the ignition, then it's like, okay, I need to put the key on again. It's like, shit, where did I throw the key? And it's stuff like that just gets under my skin, but that's part of it. But I'm not saying you shouldn't like Ford. That's why the video is called Why I Don't Like Ford. If you like them, that's great. Nothing wrong with it. You can pick them up nice and cheap now, the power strokes, build them yourself, and you got a nice, decent truck. So.
We got Bumblebee, CBR. How much would you pay for an 01 Ram 2500 Cummins? Was it worth 120... 120 kilometers, regular cab, 8-foot box.
Right, so it depends where you are and how good a shape the truck is in itself, right? We've seen lots of 16-year-old trucks with low kilometers that are just rotten to shit because they still rot whether they're moving or not. So if you're from down south, the truck's easily still worth, I don't know, $12,000, somewhere around there. Basically, when you get into old vehicles like that, it's worth exactly what somebody's willing to pay for it. If you can get 15 for it, it's worth 15. If you can get 17 for it, it's worth 17. If you can only get 8, I guess it's only worth 8. Start high and work your way down. If you're selling it.
I have to build lean to addition a park model trailer. Can you build it higher than the roof of the trailer?
Are you putting the roof kind of over the trailer so that the rain still comes away from it? I understand that you don't want the lean-to because it'll be too low over there. I guess you could go up. I don't see an issue. The problem is where your prevailing wind is coming from. You don't want the wind to catch the going over the roof of the trailer and then catching the roof, I guess. But anchor good enough, I don't see a problem. But check with your local building inspector, I guess.
Love the channel. G Money says, love the channel. You deserve more subs. Can you make a basic video of how a turbo works, components needed?
Yeah, we can do that. Actually, it's coming up. I think I'll include that in the LS video, whether it's on diesel or gas, it's more or less the same, except the gas ones will have a blow-off valve and a wastegate, whereas a diesel will only have a wastegate. So I'm going to get into that more on plumbing in the turbo, so I'll include that in maybe, I think we'll have to put the build section of the LS into a couple different sections, because we'll figure that out, but I'll include that into the LS build. But basically, I'm going to screw with Aaron. He doesn't know this either, though, because originally we were going to take both engines to the dyno, just put the junker on the dyno, get a nice tune for it, figure out the HP tuner, and then blow it up, and then move everything over to the to Neil's block, and then build it, put it on the dyno, and then just make sure it's running right. But I think what we'll do is take the junk engine, get a tune for it where we get 450 horse, 500 horse out of it, and then get a good tune going. The only thing it won't have is the good pack springs for the valves themselves, but they'll float at the top end, but that's okay. I think they'll start floating once we get over 6,000 RPM, which Neil shouldn't really be doing too much with it anyway. So I think we'll just get a nice tune for that engine and then save that on the HP tuner and then just keep tuning it until it blows up. So, and then we can just take the engine off, take the pieces off at home and put them back on Neil's engine. So yeah, we're going to put the cam into the junk engine as well. So I'm waiting for a front timing cover and the cam sensor for the front, because the first or the older generations, they had the cam sensor at the back of the LS, and the new ones have them on the front. So the cam gear itself has the cam sensor on it, so I had to order that. So it's one more thing we got to wait before we can keep going on it. But should have it this week, and hopefully put the dyno on the end of this week. So when we're building the engine, I think we'll do a clean build when we're actually building Neil's engine, because the other LS looks like crap and I don't really feel like cleaning it, spending all the time on it. So even though the Neil's engine's kind of put together now, we're moving everything over to the junk one, which we were going to do for the dyno anyway. We're going to put that in Neil's car, get it running, pull it back out again, bring it to the dyno shop, blow it up, take everything back, put it on Neil's engine, and then make the video on how to build the LS, and then take that engine and put it in Neil's car, and that's it. That's done.
Okay.
And it's not that big of a deal to pull that engine in and out of that car. It's pretty much straight up and down. Like, there's no tucking or steering. It just kind of drops in. You put the two mounts in, and then it's ready to go. So it's not as big of a deal as it sounds. So.
And when's the new LS video coming out?
Yeah. So. It'll probably be 2 weeks, I'm not gonna lie. Yeah. There's a lot of stuff going on, and just kind of keep up with our social feeds on Instagram and whatever. We're posting a lot of pictures on that, and guys, I'm honestly in love with that engine. Just the way it sits on the stand with the exhaust all on it, with the intake on it looping back, the wastegate dumping in and everything. So it's at a point now where it's awesome, because in theory, it's all perfect. There's no exhaust leaks. There's no coolant leaks. It didn't blow up, you know, and just sitting there, there's no rust on it. There's no heat marks on it. So I think I want to make put that picture on a t-shirt, actually, and call it Mer Chevy or something like that.
Come up with a name. What do you think we should call the Mercedes LS?
Yeah, actually, Neil came up with a good one. It's the GM symbol with, like, so GM, and then the line under GM, like the blue thing is. And then the M is the Mercedes, so it's GM Mercedes. and it looks pretty good.
G Mercedes.
Yeah. It's a G machine. But I think we're gonna put that in the valve covers, just like really small, not big and obnoxious like the new Rams on the tailgates and the grills, but really just do a fine touch on that, yeah. Cool. So I gotta contact my buddy with the CNC machine and see if he can throw those valve covers on just yet.
Nicholas asks, have you had any experience with either a 3.9 common rail engine or the 4.5, the newer engine?
Good question. Not yet, but we are too soon, because we are actually in talks with
Don't say anything.
With some companies, that. Okay, and there's, okay, I'll say this, where it's been a very exciting month where we talked to a lot of different companies and nothing's concrete yet.
Yeah,
nobody's actually said yes, other than HP Tuner sent us a tuner for the LS, so thanks to HP Tuners for that.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of other people that we're talking to. Another one today that wasn't scheduled, I just swung in, and we have a meeting booked with them on the 15th, and we can talk about all the cool things that are happening, but it's all, well, nothing's in concrete yet. Nothing.
Yeah,
it's all
big
coming.
Plans,
yeah,
big plans.
We've got good ideas, and you know, we've got high hopes, but even if they don't, it's just like the LS engine I was talking about, where it's in the perfect stage right now because nobody said no yet. So we can say that everybody's on board because they haven't said no yet. And it's
yeah.
not a no, but yeah. we won't start saying anything until we actually have some stuff on paper. But the common room is part of that.
Yeah. Stay tuned. Stay tuned. TCTX2 says, what should I do to stop rust where rocks are chipping paint off from off of an 06 Cummins? It doesn't have to be pretty.
So there's clear wraps that you can do. I never really got into them just yet. I kept having it with the Silverado, and that's why I paint the bottom of the Silverado black, because the stone chips just keep coming. It was a work truck. It was off-roading. And then once the stone chips eat away at the black and start to rust, you can sand it down again, paint it again quick, and then put your name down there. So the DeBoss, it was DeBoss Construction, then it was DeBoss Mechanical. Now it says DeBossGarage.com. So, and that's the third time that I've cleaned the bottom of it, just to keep up on those stone chips, because they're going to happen. It's a truck, especially if you've got bigger tires on there, that the stones get jammed into the tread and then gets flung at it. It's hard to keep anything from really putting up with that abuse. And you can put the rocker guard and that on it, but that just kind of, to me, it's like you gave up in your truck. So.
Got another question. Prep Brothers Homestead says, the builds you do are super cool. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Just quickly on that, every build I do, I'm like, man, this is like so cool. I'm like, this is the best work I've ever done. And the next job comes up, I'm like, oh, this is the coolest build I've ever done. So we're having a really good time doing it. I've had a lot of people wanting quotes on jobs that I've done already, but I do kind of want to do something different every time. So
Matt Mann says, what have you heard about the EcoBoost F-150 reliability? I might be buying my father's, but debating on getting the 5.0.
So the 5.0 is much more reliable than the EcoBoost is. On a lot of the stuff that I've been reading, is it's really hit and miss whether they love them or they hate them. So I don't know any, and I only have a couple friends that have them, but they flip them after a couple years pretty quick, so they don't really last with the they don't really stick around long enough to see whether they have problems or not. So that's my thing on Fords, is they're awesome trucks while they're still under warranty, but after that, it's time to get rid of them. So
Nancy wants to know, my 09 Saturn RS 3300. No.
330,000 on it. Well, you must have a good husband who really takes care of your car. So it hesitates between fourth and fifth gear. Do you think it's time to start shopping for a new vehicle? Please say yes. I've got my eye on the 2018 diesel Chevy Equinox. Hey, me too. That's the girl after my own heart. Yeah, son. If you stick it in manual with the paddle shifters, it doesn't do it. So I can just teach you how to do that for the next 2 years, and then in 2 years from now, the Equinox might be priced where we can afford it. Yeah.
Any thoughts on the R 2.8 Cummins coming out?
Yes, stay tuned.
Great.
Worth putting into a small truck? I'm going to say yes.
Tacoma, yeah.
Yeah.
Love the channel. Thanks from BC. Cool.
Yeah, nice.
BC, Canada.
Yeah, let us know what your emission laws are on there. If you do, email down, but or just post again a little bit down. Let us know what your emission laws are like with that engine. So,
Redneck Dave, how long can you make it? All I've found is 16 feet, 2x8s. Can you extend them? Continuation from earlier. Yeah, no permits. He's building.
Oh, yeah. 16-foot 2x8s. I've gotten, if you don't want posts in the middle, you're going to have to space them at least a foot apart. What's your snow load? What's your pitch? That all kind of comes into factor. When we get our buildings built, each zone is actually different. You can have a building completely different from, like, 10 kilometers away because they've figured out some sort of snow load that theirs is different than ours. We're closer to the lake, they're farther away. So the snow load depends on how many trusses you need, how far they're spaced away, how many headers you need, all stuff like that. So I can't really answer that question. You still got to go with your local building code. The higher the pitch, the
I think you said there are no codes where he is.
Oh, there are no codes. So then there's probably no snow either. Just comment down below again. Do you have snow?
Aaron.
Why is he going, shh?
KFR Dubber wants to know, what about Volkswagen 2.0 TDIs?
You know what? They're awesome I think they're awesome little engines. I was talking to one of the guys, I was talking to one of the guys that makes biodiesel, and he ran a TDI. He's like, why am I making biodiesel for an engine that gets 1,000 clicks to a tank anyway? So, it's literally, I think they're fantastic little engines. It's very disappointing in what happened with Volkswagen, because they were great little engines. But yeah, and as for the hands, literally, guys, I had 5 minutes in the house because of a family emergency, and I ran out here I haven't showered, I haven't shaved, my hair's a mess, so I know I'll wash my hands. I don't look like this every day, honest, but I used the Gojo before, but it's got the sand in it and starts to really get irritating on your hands. I basically just use sunlight. So.
Redneck Dave, I'm going from a 6 bed farmhouse to a trailer with a family of 6. I think he...
Okay.
I am in London.
Oh.
London, Ontario, I'm assuming?
Yes, no. So then, you want a span of 16 feet? Well, you gotta have some sort of pitch on it. You guys got a pile of snow. You can't support... You guys get more snow than we do, so... You're going to have to space those like a foot apart, and they're still going to bow. Like crazy. You guys don't have building codes? Weird. What's that?
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. Just send me a quick email to bossgarage@gmail.com and tell me what you want to do, how big, how far, how high, and maybe I'll whip up a quick drawing and send that back to you. Because we can go back and forth all night, but...
Nicholas wants to know, currently have a 3.9 common rail with an Allison transmission in my 2004 F-150, new body style, but haven't had much luck with support. I think that's continuation from, have you had any experience?
Oh, okay. Like, what's it doing? Is support how? Support from Cummins as to why it's not running right, or nobody knows what's going on type of thing?
Are you guys still looking for old truck bodies for conversion?
Yes. Oh, you're awesome. I lost your number. I actually made a video last week that we came across a Duramax with an Allison in it, and I need something cool to put it in. So I've actually, I don't know why, but I kind of have starting to really like those old C10s and Apaches, 50s, early 60s. And if you guys come across something like that, we're hopefully that comes together. So yeah, definitely. And that's a good place on the boss. You know what? Send that straight to thebossgarage@gmail.com. We got to talk. So, Silverado, hopefully when it's done, the one customer that I have, he hauls trailers back and forth everywhere. So if we can make that work and my insurance covers pulling in a brand new trailer, then I'd like to tell him, okay, when you get a load that goes out roughly to here, let me know, I'll pull the trailer there and then hire a U-Haul or something and then pull something cool back again to do the next conversion in. So we're always looking for something cool, yeah, definitely.
Noah wants to know, did you talk that guy into putting an international DT360 or DT466 into that Ford instead of a Cummins you talked about last live feed?
Never talked to him again, so I don't know what he did. I don't know what happened with that one.
Dip Master, I put a pickup. Oh, so we're gonna go over to Drive Tribe then? Is that what we're doing? Oh, I don't see one. Where'd you put it, Dip Master? I don't see it on our Drive Tribe here. Yeah, make sure you post it in the DeBoss Garage Drive Tribe. Okay, let's keep going here.
Oh, you lucky boogers. No drive emissions in Vancouver unless a cop pulls you and demands an inspection. So if he... See, I'm still... Yeah, I don't know. It depends what cop you get. How does a cop know that... How many 2.8 liters has he seen to know whether everything's on there that's supposed to be on there? Or are you saying... The cop pulls you over and he's like, that's not what that vehicle is supposed to sound like, and so you've messed with it, so I'm yanking your plates type of thing. But, yeah. I think generally, if you are civil and you don't act like an idiot to require the cop's attention in the first place, I'll probably let you go. But that's just my experience. I got a couple cop buddies, so...
Redneck Dave, land is on the...
okay, I see.
Reserve.
Right. Yeah, send me something at Gmail and I'll whip up a picture or something for you if I get the chance. It will be sketched by hand and then scanned, but yeah.
How close are we to Kitchener?
We're about an hour and a bit.
Yeah.
Yeah, hour and a bit from Kitchener.
G-Money wants to know, turbo build on 80s old... Oldsmobile 5.7 diesel.
I think those are like the worst diesels ever built. So, I don't know. Yeah.
Outdoorsman, okay, I might have something lined up in Alberta for you. It's a bit far, but I can get you pictures, C10 and stuff.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Got it, nice. Yeah. Patina, we'd be up for a road trip. That's what the video is kind of about. Finish the GTO and Silverado, and then on to the next one again. So hoping for a road trip towards the end of summer somewhere, whether it's south or west, I really don't care. So.
Nicholas said, I haven't had much support on getting more power and such.
Right.
Had it running and driving, but I'm trying to find some sort of way to tune it. So as for support, I mean, there's nothing out there for running.
Yeah.
For tuning.
Yeah, and honestly I can't give you any advice or where to go from that, but in the next few months I hope to be able to help you out there. So all I can do is say stay tuned for now. I'm pretty swamped with what we're doing right now, but there's some common rail stuff coming in the future if everything works out with people that we're talking to, so.
Drew Eaton says he's on Vancouver Island, not Vancouver.
Oh, okay, yeah. Nice.
Yeah, no E-test, that's great.
Yeah.
Dip Master, it is under Classic?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, so. Nice Durango, 4BT Durango, that's awesome. Good job, man.
No one can read these, so we gotta
figure
out what we're
okay,
looking at
I see.
Here. But Elias is awesome. 1, 2, 3.
Well, that's,
I swapped
a,
the four.
That's a bit cock.
I swapped a 4BT into a Dodge Durango this summer at age 16. I'm getting the drive shaft this week and can't wait to drive it. Looking forward to sending you pics and meeting you someday.
Nice.
Yeah, put some pics up on DriveTribe.
Yeah. That's funny because his name is Ellie is Awesome, and I said, oh, that's awesome, and then I made fun of him for saying that he's awesome. But good, right on. Good job, buddy.
Yeah, G-Money, haha, I ripped one out of my first gen Seville and put in a small block. It's my thumbnail.
Oh, nice.
JJ99, when will your next video be up? Next video will be up on Sunday.
Have you decided what it
not
is?
Not sure
yet?
What that is.
Driving here, I'm like, I wonder what video is going up Sunday.
Yeah, there's a couple options. So
okay.
We'll see.
Aaron's going to be busy tomorrow, like always.
What's your opinion on the DSS auto program?
So, I had Mr. Abel, and he was awesome. He really figured out the students and let them do what they were capable of doing. He could read the students pretty good. The last teacher I found was a joke. He had students disassembling cars for him in the shop class, and then he was scrapping all the cars. And we won't go any farther into that, but I wasn't too thrilled about that. And I've heard nothing but good things about the new teacher. So, again, if he knows about the channel and he's up for me swinging in, you can get him to email me at debossgarage@gmail.com, and we can set something up for bringing in the Tahoe or the Silverado or one of the projects or whatever. We can just chat, whatever. But I gotta have the okay from the teacher first. So if you want to get him to email me, then we can go from there. So. Yeah, boom. I've only heard of one person getting an inspection slapped on them, and that was a rusty but sweet rabbit Volkswagen pickup from the 80s with a soup can clamping muffler on. Nice. So yeah, your muffler is one of those things that really gets attention, especially when the windows are open, and a soup can is enough to get some attention. Yeah, when I say stay under the radar, I say build quality vehicles, not roadkill style, and don't speed, stop, come to stop at stop signs and leave your phones in the console.
Yeah, I would say if the vehicle looks nice and most importantly safe, there's no problem with diesel emissions.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Right.
Elias is awesome. Do you have any knowledge if I can pass a PA inspection?
Yep.
Vehicle inspection.
Yeah,
test?
I think so. I don't know whether it's got to be hardwired in or not. That it really one of those things where it depends which station you go to. Some people allow it, but it's a speedo, it tells your speed, so I've been told that that's okay.
Mr. Trolls, students at DSS in grade 10, Mr. Jamark is the new auto teacher and a Mopar guy. I could talk to him about it.
Yeah.
Okay. Redneck Dave, do you think it's worth putting rear frame rails on a 8.7 Cutlass body is good, does need floors. Body's good, needs floors.
Sure. I don't know.
All right, we're going to go back to Drive Tribal for a minute. Just take a look here. See what else we have. Because I wanted to see Rob Fox posted up his Ford for us to look at. 88 4BT Ranger. So
nice.
Let's look at this.
Oh, that's awesome. Perfect stance. I love it. How's those tires turning in the front? Nice job. Nice and clean. All insulated.
He's not online with us.
But, okay.
But, he posted,
well, if you go to Drive Tribe, check out the little Ranger. Really nice job. Everything's insulated. Wow. Nice. Yeah. Ooh, nice clean gauges. Very nice job.
Let
me hold on to that one for a while.
Daily driver?
Yeah, yep. For sure.
Yeah, cool.
Sweet.
We got one more I know about. Let's see. A lot of cool stuff here, but these are the ones that our viewers have posted. So
yeah.
The Astro Van.
That's a Cummins too.
It's got a 4BT in this thing.
Yeah. And it's driving over another car, so but it doesn't get much more awesome than that. So the guy that I'm building the LS Mercedes for actually bought an Astro Van out of Japan, 40,000K on it. So nice, sweet. It was clean car, van, whatever.
Yeah, check out Drive Tribe. Post your stuff up there. And we'll put it on our live stream. Let's go back here. Got a couple questions. No. Roadkill and this show are two of my favorite shows on YouTube.
Nice, thanks. It's awesome that we're in the same category as Roadkill. We're having a lot of fun doing it. So, yeah. Did you see how the motor warped the pavement?
In that Ranger. Oh, in the Ranger? Did it?
Oh, yeah.
Nice. I know what he's talking about. Some warped pavement here. Nice. All right, guys. If you got any more questions far away, we'll wrap this up.
Yep.
Maybe the next 5-10 minutes, depending on what we get. Let's talk a little bit, I guess, about what's happening in the shop, I guess. What's happening?
What's that?
What's
talking about the vet, because that was all Patreon, right?
We talked about the vet. We talked a little bit about the LS. That's going on. It's going to be going on the dyno pretty soon.
Yeah. Yes.
Oh, you know what? Let's talk about Oxbeam a little bit.
Yeah.
Because we posted a video about the headlight swap. And we haven't followed up with them yet, have we?
I did, yeah. I sent them an email, but I put in a pretty heavy request, so...
Oh, okay.
I just mean
about, like, an official response or anything?
No, not about the brightness of it.
Yeah,
I know that the low beams have a cover on it and it reflects it, and then there's like a on the Silverado it really does reflect it low. That's the point of it. The high beams don't. It's just the LED bulb with the reflector behind it, and that's it. There's nothing in front of the bulb. So what we should do is drive it down the road, and a big thing on that is make sure that your high beam or your bulbs are aimed properly too. If you can aim them, you can aim normal bulbs up high. And you'll get flashed on every single one of them, too, because it's just that point where it hits the other driver in their face. So if you are getting flashed a lot, make sure that your bulbs are adjusted right in the first place. But honestly, we put the bulbs in to test the brightness of them and never really thought about the oncoming traffic. So
yeah, this road,
truck's
not even on the road yet.
No, otherwise we would drive kind of opposing to each other and put the camera in the other shot and the other camera too, or in the other car. So maybe we'll do that. Biggest thing too is the Silverado needs tires. Those tires are all cupped from the Dodge that it was on. So $1,000 in tires is holding me back too, so... Just so you guys know.
Yeah, we'll put up a video in the next couple of weeks on that.
Yeah.
We also want to talk to Oxbeam and kind of get what their official response is.
So definitely check out Oxbeam's site, though. They have, they're a huge company, and they make a pile of different lights. So, the headlights are one thing, but they have a lot of beams and off-road equipment for everybody, agricultural and industrial as well. They have, what we were interested in is light bars, and they wanted to send me light bars originally, and I said no, because I'm not going to put a light bar on my truck, but I said what I will do is put some light bars underneath the rails in the box, so you don't see the lights, but it'll illuminate the box when you're trying to find something, and I said if anything, I'd put one in the bottom of my toolbox facing into the box, and then if I want to have a tailgate party or something, just drop the tailgate and kind of illuminate that, or backing up or into something, that would be really helpful. But they have lights now that pair with your phone and Bluetooth, and you can actually change all the colors on them too. So with Aaron going for some motocross
tournaments or whatever this summer, if he was able to take the Silverado and put his bike in the back and then just park somewhere and change the colors of the lights and have like a strobe effect with the bottom of the light being lit up, I thought that would look really cool on Ox Beam's credit if their lights work. But I only have 2 inches in between the outside of the box and the inside of the rail. So it only needs, so I asked for a single row of LED lights that still pair with your phone, and I could only find doubles. They're 3 inches wide, I need 2 inches wide. So she's probably like, that guy's really annoying, and
yeah,
I don't talk to him anymore. But whatever, I don't care. I'm not paying for the lights.
Yeah, it's just to show you guys how to do stuff. And
yeah, use your imagination. It's like, okay, well, the light bar on the truck fad is kind of over. What else can we do? And to me, that's a practical use. So, not the colored thing, but to light up your box so you can actually see what you're doing at night.
Are fuel lift pumps common to go in 12 valves?
Yes, and if I was to every engine that I rebuild or swap, I put a new one on just because I'm a lift pump is a lot cheaper than a starter, especially when you're doing a swap into a GM and you got to buy a piece of junk Ford 6-liter starter. Anyway, we'll talk about that.
Oh, Elias is awesome. So you go to Drive Tribe, and there's a link. There's a link in the description, I believe. Hold on, maybe not. Yeah, it's not in. I'll put it in the description, but it's also just in the video. If you click on the right, top right,
the little eye.
Click on that. It's the second button down. It's the Drive Tribe.
So it's a picture of the old Fleet Master.
Yeah, you can check out everything that's happening over there.
The GTO is going to be drivable this year. I'm sure there's going to be some small pieces of trim or anything that we're going to be missing, but in all intents and purposes, the goal is to definitely drive it this summer. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, because mine just went, and I was just wondering, Chuck is at DSS right now getting fixed up.
Oh, yeah, nice. Yeah.
Yeah, cool. All right, guys. I think we're done. We'll see you guys next time. Look out for Sunday's video.
Yep.
And go over to Drive Tribe. Show off your builds over there, and we'll put them on the channel and put them on our social channels as well. So
yep.
You can share them. So.
Thanks, guys.
Yeah.
Well. I know we said it once a month. It was January. Was it January? Oh, it's okay. If it was the end of January, it's almost a month. We'll try and keep up. We'll
try and keep up with this.
Yeah, we'll see you guys next month. Thanks for watching.
Thanks.